noted the fifth of 2008, the pastor's very distinct from my statement to the stability of the financial sector and its effectiveness. It includes the generalized increase in bank capital levels in the world, including the increase in capital levels of course, not for the stability of the globally systemically important new regulations on leverage ratios, the imposition of stress tests, mandated stress tests, profits on resolution mechanisms, limits on executive compensation, in many cases, new mechanisms in contemplation of the potential policy, and discussions of extension of new regulations to the specific. So, a lot has been done in terms of regulation that has a tendency to undercut the stability of the financial sector. However, if you notice that in general, these reforms have a rather platform character to them, rather than comprehensive in the sense of being driven by the reason of why financial system should look like in the future, and the use of the regulatory supervision to gradually drive the emergence of new financial sector. In fact, the discussion among the group focused a bit on the incompleteness of the reform and the perception that investment capital in many countries, many times, was being misallocated. Specifically, we talked about, for example, the relatively weak business investment climate in most of the industry-based economies, and similarly, like the substantial need for climate change funding that was not available at this time, despite the obvious need to develop such financial resources. We talked about the incomplete reforms with regard to the private banking system in fact, the potential problems resulting by the emergence of new instruments such as the exchange traded funds that have become huge in the last few years. We talked about the risk that seem to be associated with the increased concentration of the financial sector, about the lack of even though they have the efforts of design to implement macro-prudential policy that is important to the first reflects effective mechanisms of policy. We discussed briefly the innovations that are typically called fintech, financial business technology, and impact technology on the infrastructure. But of course, that's important broad term, and most of every financial institution classically uses such the need for technical innovation and the new developments in information technology, such as say fintech, is rather involved and a deep idea. Similarly, we didn't have much discussion of the technology of private currencies, recognizing that at this time they are at home. In the context of the global financial system, it's hard to talk about. And similarly, the likelihood of a perfect likelihood that if they became cyber currencies became more established, that they would be made cyber to affect the system. But still, as I said, the discussion of recognizing the substantial progress that's been made since the crisis. Still reflected in the same first, quite dissatisfaction with the past work in the regulatory reform. At the same time, a recognition that despite the many attempts at welcome success, some of us see the negative effects of the financial crisis on the global economy, that in fact, there is no effective mechanism that has been put in place for crisis prevention in the global financial system. One of the
Will follow to develop these more electric vehicles or cleaner renewable technology. And still, the proper standard, very proven proper standard for the future was never really strong. So, regardless, and also that one weak element in the United States is very cheap, natural gas. Shale gas revolution makes the gas so cheap that it replaces coal. And Mr. Trump will try to help coal industry, but probably the economy market will never ever get coal conductor point. So, if Trump withdrawal of Paris Accord will be confirmed that, but probably energy sector market will follow the very stringent plan of trajectory toward cleaner economy. That is one of the very surprising but interesting conclusions that we have discussed today. All these problems, China, India, ASEAN countries will continue to use coal because it's cheap and abundant, but it's a single CO2 emission and air pollution. So, some kind of new technology, cleaner coal technology, or carbon sequestration and storage is necessary, though it is very costly. Norwegian government succeeded in a huge carbon tax of $60 per ton, and Statoil in Norway is starting to see that as a commercial venture. So it depends on the government's determination to really reduce CO2 emissions by coal or some gas. Interestingly enough, some of the comments said in our workshop that Germany cannot favor coal because of labor, coal miners. So Germany is committed to the cost process. They can favor nuclear, but they cannot favor coal. So it's not interesting, but Germany is dragging feet for the agreement for the future of the COP21. This is a very interesting finding for me. Renewable energy is coming very strongly. Technology, the cost of photovoltaics is coming down very, very fast. So, can we achieve 100% renewable society in the future? This is one of my questions to your comments. Yes, it may take time and it may have a cost implication, but people say, yeah, it's possible that renewable 100%, depending on the country, depending on the region, depending on the resources for the country. The Morocco pattern is part of it. In Morocco, the state of the solar power is enormous because in the auction in Morocco, the cost of solar, which came in into the market, was only just 3 cents per kilowatt hour. This is the cheapest cost of solar in the world. So, in Morocco, it's aiming at 52% renewable energy for the power generation by 2030. So, this is a great opportunity for some countries, even in developing countries, to move away from coal or fossil fuel to the renewable, if the government has the determination to do so. Nuclear power has a problem. After pretty much even in Japan, the cost of nuclear is moving up, wasting house is going to collapse, and probably a deep light water reactor cannot be built in the OECD countries anymore, especially probably UK. But how many reactors they can build is a big question. So maybe it's China, India, Russia who will build more and more reactors, but we are very afraid that Korea, Japan, China, US, building the new reactors to replace the old ones may not necessarily be a big thing. We need to find a more sustainable nuclear power, active space, going away from the existing energy, waste management, this kind of new technology, more modular type. So we have to change the paradigm of nuclear to be accepted by public opinion. We may need more hydropower. This is another clean energy, but environment say, many senses of faith build a total faith. Real peak demand of oil coming, this is another great thing I've already mentioned, many of them say, well, it may take time, not easy. But Saudi Aramco came to Japan about a month ago and hosted a big seminar about hydrogen. Because they said, with electric vehicle will come very substantially in Europe, in China, in India, and they said, combustion, internal combustion engine vehicle will be replaced by electric vehicle. Just like this. This means that this big threat to the survival of Saudi Aramco. I ask this question to Patrick Gianni and Gianni the first day. Saudi Aramco, at least, there's a chance that this demand of oil may come much earlier than we are expecting now. So we have to prepare that kind of situation, even though the common sense of energy-related people, this is not happening so easy. So the corporations should prepare for the energy future. And very interesting, for Paul, Patrick Kiran's initiative in Paul is such that he created a department called Strategy and Climate. So his idea is incorporating climate mitigation situation into the corporate strategy. So integrating these two together. And Paul has a very high internal carbon price, $35. When they try to invest into the new technology or new ventures or new upstream downstream projects, they will charge $35 of carbon from the possible revenue to them. So, this kind of policy or strategy is a very, very significant change. Try to change people aspiring to introduce carbon pricing by emission market or carbon taxation, but we never succeeded more than 2 decades. Probably it's very difficult to harmonize this kind of institutional carbon related strategy. But if corporation is seeking internal carbon pricing, the financial market will judge. Evaluate the corporate strategy of ESG, environment, social, and corporate governance strategy is the criteria for the future investor. Japan is moving to ESG by the GPRF, the Government Pension Fund, is now putting ESG as a major criteria for their investment. So, financial self-interest to the companies will make climate change mitigation much, much more possible in the future, regardless of what Mr. Trump will do, what German government cannot do, regardless of government action. Maybe this is the future of the emission climate change mitigation. Final comment from me is that even with this reality, the government can play a very important role. When I was the head of the IRA, I'm always saying a government policy must be always predictable or stable as possible. The private sector investing in energy infrastructure in the last 40, 50 years is government take policy of on the energy related issues, because energy policy is very political in many cases. Nuclear is a case. Renewables, hydro balance, typically. So, each government changes policy, too, in the private sector in the past 40, 50 years. So, the government should set its prayer law, international coordination is necessary, but private sector efforts will yield a very significant increase for the future of climate change. Thank you very much.
I'm going to talk about the work of Christian, but quite a public important.
need to focus on four points. The first point is outcome of the analysis and to develop the capacity set, they're going to have to follow the rest of our forces in that development. But they have to find their own housing address and find themselves also in that development. So, in the next 5 years, China will have more continuity on peace and foreign policy, and there will be more free instruments. So, and foreign policy will be more problematic. You know, after the obvious in that way, there are some counter-arguments from the Kremlin. By the year 2050, China is going to become an arbiter in the Asia-Pacific region or region. So we could easily expect China will be more assertive in the next 5 years to come. And also, when another company is arguing that China, China has 14 less neighbors. But they don't want to allow it to China, even though they want to enjoy more trade with China. So, and also China has entered a conflict with many neighbors. So, the sweet spot to improve our relations with neighbors after the announcement of our conflict with China. and say the poet, right, the or the question of the movie field about the movie generation for the first time in the more than 20 years, the time to say, the
We had four spaces in the number, and then we still have more time with the grouping the first into three thirds of the four spaces coming from the moon space, from the space of democracy, from the space of security, and even from the political space. So, these years after where we are, except in terms of social concept, and we are almost fighting in Israel, in Syria, and some other places through the world. So from this point of view, it just wasn't happening for 20 years, it's super difficult. Most of the speakers on the Russian side were in favor of the concept of bipolarity. New bipolarity where China will be a democracy country, including Russia, Iran, and some others. And the West will be led by the United States and the democracy country. And this bipolarity will be a determining factor for Russia to position itself as a major ally of China and this bipolar world. Where do we stand now from the point of view of the future of the Western in the world? Soviet Union produced at the peak about 19% of the world GDP. That now produces 1.5 or 5 to 2%. That's better at the world in terms of the economic way, so to say. GDP production is aware of the same place at the moment, and La Nina model, shown by one of the Russian participants, and it was 15th place in 20 years. So we're going down in the economic economic way. Russia at the moment needs human capital and leadership, the most important group, investment capital and leadership, because of the tension from the West and lack of the current structural reform, and technological capital, because the abundance of oil and gas for the last 15 years brought us to the situation where the scientific investment the fundamental research and educational system did not expansion. So, from this point of view, we are in the position where independent and autonomous development of Russian Federation doesn't really matter, so you have to build up alliances. If we are interested in the West, some participants would say, well, let's go to the East. Some other participants would say, this is a very bad idea, because even Chinese autocracy would require from Russia serious structural reform to be a so, better put your own house in order first, and then go and see. From the point of view of trade, Western participants of power in the campaign table would say it's much better to visualize the reset of Russia with the European Union and with the Western economy, because we need you and we need that. How to do this is a big question mark at the moment. Because President Putin definitely feels himself offended by Western behavior. He started in 2000 as a friend of Bush, as a friend of the line, as a friend of the West. He opened up his possibilities after September 11th to the Americans on the hinterland of Russia, among the alliance in the Middle East. He felt in any way secured in Afghanistan. In the fight against Taliban, he closed up to Samaran base in Vietnam, big effort to military fight. He closed down big base in Cuba, huge effort for the military and from the intelligence. Aspiring to do something better, for example, no military ground, to the Golden Border, nothing of that kind happened. So, at the moment, he feels offended. He doesn't trust the West, he's talking. But he's a man of, I'm sorry, I have to speak about the the defense is speaking about what members of the appropriately and roughly tradition is built genetically. So, we're running for the next term in March next year. And despite of two concepts inside Russia, with Russia, to autocracy or to democracy, is very clear to not be neglected. And it found reflection even during our round table among Russian participants. So it's not a done deal. Russia joining the bipolarity on the same side. But we have to keep in mind that the divisive theory that who controls the world that controls the world is a very serious concept. And from this, we cannot neglect one way or one day away one belt theory. We cannot neglect the attempt of the Western democracy to get its way into the Eurasian hinterland. But it will be in a position to think about its role in the future, but if this role will not be made up by Russian people only, the position of the large West United States and England, and the position of the People's Republic of China will largely influence future decisions. And here I will say that the theory in the West about Russia's future and about Russia's role in the world are totally different. I met people who say, okay, Russian people are part of Europe, like my question about that, and we will get over the difficulties. Even during Putin's time, with some intuition and with some measures to what he said. But there are some other people who say never with Putin. We have to confine and contain the present administration. We have to be very strict and sanctioned and hold other isolation measures vis-à-vis Russia. And that would, of course, mobilize the technological, national, and military last of our population, and then, of course, I think that by pushing us into the embrace of China, this not really necessary mode will take place. So, there is negative and positive scenarios of the development of this bipolarity if we are pushed into this embrace of China. The negative will be the British people told us. A certain China, nationalism, socialism imposed on the survival and so on and so forth. And that's a helping militarily and from the point of view of the political position. But there is another scenario. And this is, of course, too more of a dream than a practical scenario. This is the scenario which academician Sakharov, the father of Russian democracy, American economists like Rothbard, Bloomberg, like Louis Stiglitz, are playing with. This is the scenario of conversion, which is the best of socialism of China and FDR society. Social justice, the drive to bring the disparity between the wealth and the poor, and it is the best from the economic efficiency of the West, and gradually, through normative and analytical methods, we build up a model of global governance which is more concentrated. At the moment, it looks like a dream. But many people work on this thing from this normative and analytical point of view. There are models of how this could be done in principles in future. That's not realistic at the moment. I don't understand that. But in any Russia, there will be no other way because we don't want to be the frontier in the fight between Chinese and Americans. We want to be at the prayer of our home. We want to control our own ways and space, our own in terms of living together with those nations. We need to get in terms of incorporation, be before we see and what we put. So, negative scenario. In 20 years, we're in a real fight between autocracy and democracy. And positive scenario. We managed to build the bridges. We managed to create new ideas. And we make a huge step forward in terms of global governance together. Thank you very much. The workshops were so rich that the even summarized report had reached all the time. So we're being kindly asked to make way for the next.